Welcome everyone to Autogefühl, your number one resource for in-depth car reviews. This is Thomas for you, today with the Bentley Flying Spur. Under the hood we get the W12, so there are these two versions, W12, 6 liter of displacement, or the V8, the newer one with 4 liters of displacement. This one is the heavier version actually, but everything else rather remains the same. So today, a very exclusive Bentley review here with the exterior, interior, of course, especially in the interior, also with the rear part, because it's also a chauffeur car. And we also test the driving experience, of course. So this is real British luxury here today. And what do Germans and British guys have in common? Of course, also our fans. We sometimes have bad weather, so it's really rainy here today. Sometimes it's dried out. I hope we manage it today, but well, everything of this we're doing for you, so let's start. Starting with the front design, and this is really what Bentley is loved for, this huge front grille with the chrome structure. And I really love chrome grills, just my favorite here also from the design part on the outside. I think this is really what distinguishes this car. And the Bentley wings here on the upper part, that's the logo. And when you take a look at the headlights, this is the classic style round headlights. And well, some like them, some not. What about you? Do you prefer to have these classic round headlights here on? You might call this color British Racing Green. Well, it is kind of this color, but it's not. It's called Light Emerald in this case here. I wouldn't pick it personally, but I think to a British car, it is very fitting. We got 21-inch alloys here, really huge, but they are also hiding these huge carbon ceramic brakes, 10K extra for these special disc brakes here. I would rather go with the 20-inch alloys because they get scratches too easily. In general, if you look at this side perspective, 5.30 meters is the length of the car. Not the longest one in the Bentley setup, because there's also the Molson available. And you know, this one here is also being formally called Continental, so Continental Flying Spur. And the other ones, Continental GT and GTC, coupe and convertible. So formally you really know, okay, these ones are the coupe and convertible versions of this car. Since 2013, there's a second generation of this car. Is it really a new, completely new generation? It is doubtful if really so much has changed, but officially it's the second generation since 2013. And then they have dropped the Continental name to differentiate those model lines a little bit more from each other. But I think Flying Spur is still a very cool name, in my opinion. So, and if you look at the basic line here, it's really classic design. Classic sedan style with very strong shoulders here. You see this part is set apart a little bit, that the shoulders are very strong. But in general, well, this car is kind of made to last very long also from the design. So you could have bought that car maybe 15 years ago, or maybe in 15 years, and it would be still kind of the same. This is an advantage of designing something in this classic way, I think. But of course, there are also other more modern approaches nowadays. But I want to hear your opinion on that. What do you prefer in this kind of market in here? How do we see a difference from the outside? W12, otherwise we would have the V8, but you see there's some kind of white glue on it, I think. Maybe not the cleanest solution. You know, everything is so perfect with this car that everything which is not exactly perfect also has to be found. The vintage part of this car is definitely the rear. Look at this one. I also thought about that when reviewing the Continental GTC, also check that one in the video description. I'm not really sure about this rear. I would have expected like a little bit something newer that's also more fitting to the front design. I think especially the rear lights, they look a bit old school. Yes, this has to be still very elegant and also classic, but also not maybe too old school. So I would expect a little bit more there. What do you think? Then we see from the W12, well, the exhaust has to go somewhere, very prominent here. And what is quite of special, it's kind of a diffuser thing, not a real one, but you see there's a gap between here. Also quite interesting solution. By the way, for us, it's of course never pleasant to film in the rain, but I think when you see some water on the car, on a clean car basically, I think it looks very beautiful. Or what do you think, guys? By the way, for this car here, 165 grand in Germany is the price, the base price. But this very test vehicle has options for over 60,000 euros in it, where you usually buy maybe an Audi A6 for. So 230,000 euros for this very vehicle here, if you want to buy it new. By the way, we also see this insurance saving split here, that the bonnet isn't going all the way in the front, but here it's a clever solution, but because it's used here as a design element, because the whole grille has done the same element. But here again, well, I'm not sure if they think about saving cost when doing a crash. So let's open the master. Twin turbo, 6 liter of displacement, W12. Of course, it's how the cylinders are actually soldered on. Different from a V, like the V8. This one here is 625 horsepower. The V8 would have had 507, is 90 kilograms lighter. So this is, well, a little bit heavier than with, and of course, even more consumption. I can already tell you right now, 16 liters is a totally normal consumption here. I think 14 liters is officially. The V8 will be some liters below that for sure. But then again, this W12, also it's kind of a faster acceleration, 4.6 seconds from 0 to 100 kilometers, and the V8 would be 5.2 seconds. And today we also do a 0 to 100 speed test exclusive for you here. And we of course also take a look at some very interesting gadgets, small mobile gadget I'll show you later on in the interior review. While it's raining again outside, let's take a look at the interior here. Basic cockpit overview. You see, this is a pure Bentley style, and it's all very clean and elegant. Elegant, yes, it's elegant. You see it, especially here, this whole one piece, and that it's symmetrically, but with a round structure flying in here, like the flying spur. I think this is so beautifully done. We got the dark walnut wood panel here. However, I would rather pick a matte bright one. I love matte and bright wood, but of course this is definitely fitting to the car as well. Then what I also loved is the feature, also printed in this Continental GTC. This is the way here to open and close the vents. This is closed, this is open then, and it's all inspired by machines, you know, from engine parts, and so that's really beautiful. And of course the classic Bentley analog clock, which is created here by Breitling, has to be in this here. The infotainment unit, however, well, this one, you see it in the map, it's not reacting quite fast, really takes some time. Also not the best touch experience, cannot really use it like an iPad, or if I just browse everything else, it always takes a second to think about what it's actually doing. And that's definitely not the most modern system. It is a basic Volkswagen system, basically, yes. But you see, always takes time to change. And you might expect paying 200,000 euros for a car. You also expect the most modern infotainment system. But you know, these Bentleys, see, they aren't produced every year on a new term and not always facelifted, because no mass cars, and they therefore also don't receive the most modern infotainment systems. Also, we got a lot of buttons below here, but they feel good at least. You got a kind of good surface just to feel. We can, for example, control the vents. And then one of my favorite stuff in here is the shifting lever. It's kind of rough checkered structure around here. So beautiful done. So it's always fun. You have to press it up here and then take it back. Always fun to shift. Let's go into the details. Look at the inside of the doors. Although, you know, I'm not a fan of real leather. It doesn't have to be real leather here, but how it is done, it is very beautiful with this raffle structure. Everything is so refined in the handwork. Also, you see the contrast stitches and how everything leads to another. Also, the contrast colors, that is very beautifully done. I think here, one of the special things of Bentley. We can put the key manually in, by the way, on the left side, and then also start the engine by this, but I'm not sure why I should do that. I can also just do it with a start and stop knob. This is the key, by the way. It has a beautiful design with the Bentley wings. Also here at the sides with this checkered socket, but the rubber on the inside, this is actually feeling very cheap. I would expect something more of that, because it gets sticky. You know, as soon as the rubber is getting sticky, it's also diffusing into your skin. That's not good. So then the steering wheel. I love that here we also have the contrast here between the two colors. Also just a piece of artwork, or how would you call it? And that we also got the checkered structure here from the aluminum on the, for example, this is for the automatic cruise control and volume, for example. Right side to control the middle screen. You can connect your iPhone, for example, in the center part. If you put Neuer Benutzer, that's German now, that's for a new account for the phone. And you can also change to every other, for example, the digital speedometer here in the middle part, or have some navigation. Here's the compass, but you can also have the navigation info there. The rest of the instruments, you see they're all in this very classic style, analog with the Bentley B. And we like that it's still in the classic kind of way. How much fuel is used? Well, if you're really saving fuel, about 13 liters for sure, but usually you have to think about 16 liters or 100 kilometers here with the W12 engine. Let's take a look at the lower part here. This is the start-stop button for the engine I've talked of. And seat heating, seat cooling, actually in three levels. You also can hear it. But it's coming a lot to your lower back. There it's very strong. I would prefer it if it's also reaching the upper back and also the panties, actually. That would be better than instead of having a strong focus on the lower back. This is the adaptive suspension. I can put it to comfort or sport. I'll also soon show you in the multimedia screen how that works. This one is here for the back shade. You maybe heard it already. I can also show you later, because it's quite fun. You can also do it from the back. This is here for the height of the suspension, because we can put it up. And then for the co-driver seat. In the middle here, we got place for your glasses, but your glasses shouldn't be too thick, then they are not fitting in there. Two armrests, adjustable. You can open them, for example, to put a SIM card in here. And then you can also go online with the rear seat entertainment. On the other part, there's also a mobile phone in here. Hello, Autogefühl calling. But I'm not quite sure what use is this when we put the SIM here. Then we can put both armrests up, and then we can see what's behind. That's also nice. It's a rubber pad, actually, you can remove to get the trash out or whatever, or that you can just clean it easier. But then again, in the rubber, we got the comp structure. That's really beautifully done. Also, this splitter here, with artificial leather, and one of my favorite features really, that the 12 volt plug here, which is the cover, also has this kind of checkered structure around here, like the shifting lever or some knobs. That is really, I would say this is Bentley here, don't you think so? I want to show you the adaptive suspension. If I press the knob, then this one here appears. I can put it from comfort. You see it's also, again, slow reaction time here. From comfort to sport, I can also use this one here. Then it's a little bit stiffer then. But in general, of course, the car is definitely set on comfort. Then I can also put the car higher. This is for the Niveau then. And then we can put it higher to have a little bit more ground clearance when entering a very steep basement garage. Okay, let's see. Maybe turn on the engine, then it will be possible. Steep basement garage or maybe some speed bumps, then we can put it up. So now it's working, and now we don't see it on camera. We can show it from outside later. Now we're being lifted up a little bit, but we're going back to normal. Of course, Bentley is using real leather here and a beautiful waffle structure. However, I think luxury does not have to be combined with pure leather. You can also use a very high class artificial leather. There's a leather called Nautic leather, and that is even more expensive than genuine leather because it's even better. It's, for example, used for boats. It's more more robust for the outside, but still a very high class quality. And also we've seen the Bentley GTR, the Continental GTR 3, and that one has Alcantara here on all the middle part, so Bentley can do seats which do not kill animals with great Alcantara on the inside. I would prefer if this is also possible for this very car. Then you can change the position of the seat, of course, variable times. Also, for example, increase the length. You can see it at the very front. This is a very good feature for tall people. And there's also a massage function available, which is going all the way up here then. And even more, for example, you can put the lumbar support in four ways. So everything you can imagine to turn the seats upside down, kind of. Very beautiful also this part, how the dashboard is overlapping. We hardly see that in any other automobiles. And then I'll show you, this is how a glove box is supposed to open. Slowly sliding down. Beautiful. What else is there to say to the cockpit? We got this classic sedan style on the outside. The same counts for the inside, actually. And this is very exciting because other modern new sedans, they get a little bit bulky also on the inside. The dashboard is coming way towards you. This kind of sporty style. The windows get slimmer. And also on the inside of the doors, they kind of go inside and reduce the space. Here we really have a lot of space left, and because the doors are also relatively slim from the inside, you also don't feel that you lose overview. Now when I'm going inside the basement garage, for example, I'm actually not afraid of scratching the car because I really see where it is ending also at the sides, and that I think is a very good aspect about this classic layout. By the way, you can also electronically adjust the head restraint. And what is even more funny, look at this one here, the seat belt holder. I can control it from the lower part of the seat as well. And I can also move it up and down. About the rear seats, this is of course crucial in this car because it's also a chauffeur car. However, the Mulsanne, it's actually one car even like bigger above. So this one is not the longest and the most chauffeur-like the sedan from Bentley, but of course, the space is way enough here already. We've now put the co-driver seat all the way in the front, as it would be in a real chauffeur car. And then, of course, we have plenty of space. But also, when you get a tall driver and that would be in the seat next to me, there would still be kind of this kind of knee space. So that would still be perfectly fine. Then, what is special here, they can also adjust the seats in the rear. For example, you can put the seat here higher in the front or lower, that is possible. And the other, well, you can also adjust the lumbar support. Just listen to it. You can really see it, but you can listen to it. That's the lumbar support coming. And the massage function is also available here. it's not that evolved that, for example, in the Mercedes S-Class Coupe, also check out that review there on the video description. But again, well, it's quite cool to have the massage function, but you cannot really adjust it. It's just going on and off, and then it's going from the lower part to the upper part, but there are no different models then. And then another solution here for the seat is that you can get it to the front. And you see, now I'm already got this rather lying position here. So I sometimes prefer sitting in the rear of an SUV because you have a rather upright seating position here. You have to really think about sedan is more like lying back. And then you can also put a seat here to the front. And what happens is the seat is actually moving forward. And you see the back part of the seat is moving downward. So that is an even more lying position then if you really want to relax and take a nap also, for example. So then you also can see the difference how much height the seat lost here actually. So that would be then the difference. So that is really pure luxury here in the back. Soon we're also going to show you the multimedia system here because that's also very exciting. But from this perspective, we can better show you this part here, small beverage holder, then another hidden space for whatever something. Then you can put in headphones here, normal headphone entry, we'll talk about it very soon, and two 12 volt supplies. With an adapter, you can also charge your laptop then, but you need the adapter for it. And then, what does a real Bentley sedan has to have? What do you expect? First of all, this is again for another Bentley mobile phone you can put in there, but then two cooling functions for what? Yes, of course, for the minibar. Here it is. You can put some champagne in there and cool it. Most important here. We got the same very beautiful vents here. We can close and open again with this valve kind of mechanism, very beautiful. And then we got this rear seat infotainment box. It's quite a funny solution. You got a touch screen on here, but you can also use the buttons on the left. And first of all, you could also just use it here, for example, to have the vented seat function for the rear. Or, that's actually quite good, you can use vented seats and heated seats at the same time. So when it's raining like now, you can get warm and dry out at the same time. That's very good. Three levels both. But then you maybe want to take it in your own hand. And now look at this funny function. Oh, spacey stuff. Then I can take it just with my hand. And then I can control it here because we, you know, we got the screens here. And this is not a touch screen. I think it would have been more useful if it was a touch screen, but it is not. So. But we can first of all control everything else here. I can also change it to the controls in the front that I can actually, when I put map here, for example, you see it also in the front screen in here, I can really change what's going on in the front. So I can annoy the driver. Ha ha, I'm changing the screen for you in the front. That's a really funny thing actually. What else is possible? I can, of course, use the climate function here. I just showed you. For the seats, by the way, here, very beautiful that we have everything visualized. You see, got the red seat now as it's heated. Now with a small vent, this is so cute, isn't it? They really, I love those details if they implement those. Then you can also control the rear shade with it. You see, and it's also, this got the sliding function, and we can take a look at the rear then. You see? Still here, and then we got this rear shade. And if I then slide it up, that's really like you can play around with your luxury car. So that's it for here. And then we can also check some vehicle data. For example, I can check the speed, which is obviously zero right now, but isn't it so cool that we got an tachometer here, which is actually going, we'll test it later if it's really working live as well. Maybe this is also a way for a good acceleration video, isn't it? Really cool stuff. Then there's this multimedia system here in the rear. activating now the right screen. Now it's activated up here. And that is really weird because it's obviously not a touchscreen. I would expect that from here now. It's for example, you've maybe seen the new Audi iPad. That is maybe a better solution than here. But then, how can you actually control it? It's a little bit strange. It is kind of the touchpad is here in this small device. And then you have to go like this to choose everything. And maybe a good example is that I can show you some media. I got a USB stick here. And then I can put it in this multimedia box below here. We got USB, HDMI, SD, or also DVD. Put it just here in the USB slot. And then maybe I get ready for my viewing experience. Maybe put something on here, whatever. Or I just check if I'm looking very good. Okay, yeah, I'm looking normal. Get ready to watch something. And then we click on the, we just click once to have the media. And then I have to go to USB. And then I can watch here my latest motocross race. Where again? No. Want the screen to disappear and see if it does automatically. You see it's also the remaining time, 40 minutes for the whole race with the commentary and so on. Now we have the full screen. Greetings to all our friends from the US, by the way. But you know, these are the American motocross series. We just see Justin Bauscher here. And actually, well, it's a quite good view on that one. I would really love to watch the race here right now while driving. That's really, really cool, actually. So then I'm forgetting it's just an iPad. How fast it's playing? Maybe it could be a little bit more smoother. I think it's not the highest frame rate it's playing right now. And now about the sound. We've tested it a couple of times here now. We didn't get it actually on the speakers. I'm not sure if that's possible at all. If you know if it's possible, then tell us in the comments. We really have had to use the headphones then. And you see it's always kind of complicated to go back to the system again, and really takes a lot of time. But then there are some special headphones available, and they're right here, two pairs of them with a Bentley bag and also Bentley branded headphones, foldable system, Bentley headphones. Also can put on power, but I think they have to be plugged in. Well, these put here the fancy DJ Bentley headphones, but then they are with a USB slot here. And if I'm watching the film via USB now, where should I put it? Okay, if I got it on the SD card now, all right, DVD, no problem. But then I would have had space for that one. But then you can't use this one, you have to use your own headphones. Shown you here in the lower part, there are two slots for the headphones, and I've just tested it. If you put them right here, you got the sound here from the right screen then. And there are also some functions on here. Let us turn on the left screen. Now the left one is activated. Let's try if we can. Yes, this is a called cross view. So we have the same on both screens, but I can also put that one off. And then we have both screens separated. For example, if you have two people in the back and one wants to watch motocross and the other one wants to watch towards Bambi or something like that, then it's also possible. Just want to show you this. Besides of the tachometer, you can also put it to the driving data, actually. How much you've driven, how long, temperature outside. Well, rainy and 17 degrees, not too pleasant. Switch around again, then you got an analog clock. But I'm also looking forward to see it turning while we drive. And by the way, you see right now, you see kind of nothing because I have behind the window and also got the shade lower. There's also an electric function. And first of all, if I press down the button here, I can lower the shades. And then if I press it down again, I can also lower the window. And I can do the same thing actually for the shade on the left side, because maybe I'm just sitting here alone. And then I can also first of all, lower the left shade, and then is a second part, lower the left window. Also a very nice function here, makes it even more exclusive. So, and then it's also very interesting when I get out here. Let me first put up the windows again. So when I get out, there's a nice function. When I, for example, was a little bit in the front with my seat now, and then open the door, see, the seat is automatically driving backwards. We already know that function from a front driver seat, that the steering wheel is lifted up and the seat is getting backward, but haven't seen it here with rear seats so far, but that's included in here. By the way, this is here all the stuff where you can control the seat. Just that one is not active. You can do anything with it. But here it's the controls I've shown you before. Also the massage function and memory set, of course, is available then. And let me get out. And a function which is included with all four doors, and finally it stopped raining again, is this soft close. W12, by the way. And now I just push it very gently. And now you see electronic close here. It's available with every door. It's checked here with the driver door as well. This is also this very luxury function. Let's take a look at the boot. We say boot today, not trunk. Let's open the boot. And do it right here. And directly check, is it safe? Yes, Bentley can do it with the safety mechanism. We've tested a lot of other cars where it wasn't possible. Let's open it and let's close it again. Boot close. You see, it says boot here and yeah, it stops. So, other manufacturers, even inside the Volkswagen Corporation, we've seen it with the Volkswagen now, we've also seen it with the Skoda. The safety mechanism, well, maybe it is possible there, but it's not sensitive enough. Here, Bentley manages it to, for example, protect children from getting stuck here, and I think that's a very good thing. So, then let's take a look inside. And actually, for a luxury sedan, not too small, quite going steep in here. This one here is your refrigerator. And so you see also the vented function here for the refrigerator. This is really needing some space. But then again, for a big suitcase, absolutely no problem here. What I also want to show you is when I put up this beautiful bright boot mat that we got, and that is an option, a replacement tire in here. This is really on the list of options then. And well, not the main reason why the option says is €65,000 in here. That is mainly due to the ceramic brakes and the rear infotainment system. But again, also an option because some of you say, I really want a full replacement tire. Gentlemen, start your W12 engines. It's actually not that loud. Let's put it in neutral and let it. The engine is still quite a bit warm, otherwise I wouldn't do it because that would be bad for the engine. Yeah, that actually sounds quite nice, but you already heard that it's not that exaggerated actually. And now I'm also testing the vehicle data, if the speedometer is actually working then. Let me put it to the D mode. Let me check it first myself. Is that working? Yes, it's working. I'll show you in the camera. That's so funny. And then you can see me sitting in the rear seat. Now you see how it works. That is so cool when you're sitting in the rear and then you can see the speed going up and down. That's really a funny thing. Now let's concentrate on driving and forget about the gadgets. So, oh, it's such a relaxed ride here. The sound insulation is really superb. I already hear that right now. I can just very easily talk. Also, don't have to raise my voice that loud. That's really relaxing. The seating position. Usually I do prefer SUV seating position because you sit upright here. That is very important, especially for tall people. But for some classic concept car seats, these ones are really very good, feeling very comfortable. They're not offering too much support on either side. They're more like these open seats where you can move around freely, but they're really comfortable. I could very well imagine riding a long trip with it. The steering wheel is actually, there's a space for the thumb on the steering wheel where you can just rest them on. That's a quite a thing, neat stuff. And the steering wheel itself, also think it's really great. Is the steering direct? It's not too indirect though, but it could be a little bit more direct, I would say. It's not really progressive. You need some more steering ways in some other cars, definitely. If you want to have it a little bit sportier, when we, for example, now do some right and left turn, it's actually quite okay. The car is not going to either fight too much. You know, I've shown you this dynamic chassis control, and let me check out how the difference is actually. Now I've set it all to comfort. It's comfort, it's very soft, but actually not too soft. Now I put it to the sport, and it's, well, quite of a difference. Some vehicles, they have big difference in that one, some don't. Yeah, I feel a small difference, but here that's the case that you don't feel such a difference. It still remains to be very comfortable, and that's also the main purpose of this car, of course, especially for the passengers in the rear, which are not here obviously yet. But would you like to be chauffeured by Autogefühl, by me? Then write me in the comments, that would be very funny, I think. So on again, because the car is so long, also got this long wheelbase, we got a very steady front running car. So it's, for example, very good on the motorway then, just to go straight. But then I can, of course, when you get into sharp corners, it's not that agile. And I can also test it when I'm increasing the speed. And then as soon as we get faster, it is still fun to drive this car fast, definitely. As soon as we got very smooth corners, it's really great because we're running that smooth into this long corner. That's really great. Now a bumpy road, that will be very exciting. Yeah, it doesn't get too loud in here. I think the suspension masses it quite well. When I'm trying to steer on the bumps, it's also quite good, yes. Now going into the sharp right corner and trying to push the car a little bit inside. Then I'm starting to feel the tires a little bit pushing to the outside, but that's normal for such a car with such a weight. Well, if you think about you want to have a real huge sedan and still want to be very sporty, then I can really recommend you, in this case here, stay with Bentley, go to the Continental GT or the GTC as a convertible. There you have not so much space in the rear, so the car is more agile then. And also the Mercedes S-Class Coupe, that was really superb in sportiness. And that I can also say, just from a technological side, it's not the newest stuff we find with Bentley. Then you, for example, have to go to Mercedes then, in this case, just from a technology part. But of course, here you get this very bespoke Bentley feeling. You're feeling more special. And, well, yes, it's always good when the technology is up to date, but that's maybe not the most important aspect of the car. On the one hand, you can argue, if you spend so much money, you want also the latest technology. Yes, definitely. On the other hand, you maybe think, okay, if I got such a great interior, such exclusiveness, then it's maybe also not, well, too bad when something is missing on the technology part. So let's check the turning circle here on the small parking lot. Let's see. It's actually quite okay, I must say. I would have expected a bigger turning circle, but here I'm doing second turn now. That's actually quite okay. I've experienced smaller cars that were harder to control, even, for example, also inside the basement garage. So that's really fine, I mean, I'm quite surprised with that one there. And now let's push the engine a little bit. Watch out, putting it down. Whoa. That one was the mobile device flying around here. I need to secure it. But that is actually showing you how much power is being created here. Even with such a heavy car, you still got this kind of explosive acceleration. However, speaking of explosive, with this W12 engine, it's playing such a sovereign that it's so harmonic in the acceleration. So it's not like with the turbo, you have to wait a little bit and then it really sits in like this. I mean, small turbo engine. This one is also a dual turbo, yes, of course, but I mean, the difference between big displacement and the small displacement. The small displacement turbos, you have to wait a little bit, then the turbo really sits in, you feel it. But here, due to this huge displacement here, 6 liters, you're always accelerating, that you got the acceleration just easily. You press the throttle just a little gently, and then the car is already smoothly being driven forward, and that's a really an advantage of the big engine. But I'm quite sure the V8 would be enough totally, and that's really fine. So I've also driven several V8s, and even for this car, that would be perfectly fitting then. Really enjoying this very silent ride here in the car. Definitely, that I think is one of the most or the best features here, and especially for the people in the back. And yeah, I'm starting to get more fun also in this smooth corners here. So it's of course not a real the car that is hunting any curves. It's like a small sports, definitely will never be. But for such a heavy car, I think it's still pretty much fun to drive it, especially also with the steering wheel. As I said, steering could be a little bit more direct, but that is quite a fine. And what I realized, when you're quite fast and then going over some bumps in the corner, then you feel the suspension is maybe setting the car, like hopping the car around. I've experienced better luxury suspensions in this case here. So overall, I think very good. Not really perfect from driving in this case, but that's again this British luxury attitude. We do everything so bespoke, but on technology side, they are not always perfect, but they also do not have to be. So that was our acceleration test. The road is still wet, so we won't actually have the best result, but maybe you counted actually how fast the car was going and said 4.6 seconds would be the official value, and then we can compare how fast we actually were on this slightly wet road. How can this power be get to the ground with such a heavy car? Well, the all-wheel drive. Permanent all-wheel drive in here. Usually the setup is 40% of torque in the front, 60% in the rear. Then it's switched around. However, the grip is on the front or rear axle. Front can be maximum 2/3 of the power, and rear is maximum power to 90%. So this switches up and forth then, but of course more generally is directed to the rear wheels, that you have this more sporty approach then. So let me conclude about the Bentley Flying Spur. I think it's just really classic, elegant sedan, true Bentley, especially with this prominent front grille. I really love the design from the front and on the side. Not really a fan of the rear design though. I would have expected something more modern there. The interior is really bespoke, as you call it, especially with this contrast colors. There are so many different variations available. Also this classic layout where you have a lot of space on the inside. I like that very much, and especially the details also, like the valve buttons for the vents for opening and closing it. The infotainment system has to be more modern. I do expect that from such an expensive car though. And what else, of course, about the animal issue, I would have wished that you also picked the Alcantara seats there, which we have already seen in the GTR 3 from Bentley. That would have been a great solution. So there are surely some customers who say, okay, I do have a lot of money, but I want to combine luxury with sustainability. It is easily possible with modern means, and it should also be offered here with the Bentley. So also from driving, what I do have to comment on that one, of course, it's still a very heavy car, huge acceleration, of course, although due to this big engine, but let's be serious, a V8 is really enough for this car. You don't really need the W12, and it's even heavier, so I would rather go for the V8. That's perfectly fine then as well. And it is actually quite fun of driving it also fast, but then if you're going to, well, sharp corners, it's really pushing you to the outer because of the weight, and then the fun is actually not there, not that prominent anymore. So it's more this really very relaxed ride. So good sound insulation, that it's so quiet on the interior, especially good for the people that are being chauffeured. Then also with the rear multimedia system, quite funny thing, but maybe a little bit complicated that you don't have the touchscreen. So these ones were my thoughts here on the Bentley. Looking forward to your comments and how you liked our British episode here today. Special greetings again to all our fans from the UK, and I hope to see you at the next AutoGefühl episode.